Bryson DeChambeau, 3-under, 67. Bryson, 6 birdies in a round at Pinehurst in a U.S. Open. How does that sound?
Amazing. Made a lot of great putts today, I tell you that. Pleased with how I struck it for the most part. Got to work on that just a little bit, but I feel pretty confident over the tee shots. And, you know, I'm just going to say it tomorrow. It's the same same quote I've said all week, you know, trying to have boring golf, and middle green never moves. So I'm going to try and hit a lot of the greens, give myself some good looks on some holes, and two-putt a lot.
We're going to start here on the right, Sean, then Brentley.
A lot of fan support for you out there, Bryson.
Yeah, it was amazing. I can't thank them enough. It was a blessing, and man, they riled me up.
As someone who feeds off of that, what does it look like? How does it show itself in your play, feeding off of fans?
Well, it just gives me a spike in my adrenaline and allows me to focus more on delivering for the fans and for myself and for my family, and it just inspires me.
Here, Brentley on the right.
Bryson, after the shot you hit on 13 in there, and we're looking at a birdie putt, I don't think you hit the putt for like another 10 minutes. Obviously, Ludwig was having some difficulties. What all did you think about during that time, and what's the challenge of having to kind of wait on a birdie putt like that?
I mean, it was possibly, besides 14, the next hole, the most difficult putt I've had all week, from a downhill slider. Late in the afternoon, it's not perfect. Everybody's walked over it, so definitely trying to look and see how the ball's going to move. It was one of the most difficult putts I've had. So for me, it's just about looking at it, being focused, trying to stay focused for 10 minutes. I mean, look, for the most part, I was just trying to walk around and keep my body moving, but just looking at the putt, trying to hit it 6 inches outside the hole at 7-inch pace. I mean, that's all I was trying to do on that putt, and barely missed it, but... yeah, I don't really know. I was just kind of in my own world.
Here on the left, Mike.
Bryson, can you just take us through the hip issue that you were having today and how much it impacted you, if any?
Yeah, I mean, it was tougher to get through in a couple shots, and it's okay. I've had it for a long time now. Just something that popped up. I've been playing a lot of good golf lately, and working on my house, trying to get my house finished, so I haven't really had time to rest like I want to. The 2 weeks I had off after PGA, I was really grinding and focusing on some stuff there. So I wasn't really able to rest, and I've just been pushing myself a little bit, pushing the horse a bit. And consequently, that's going to happen. But luckily, I've got a great team around me to help fix some stuff up. Ryan Overturf's here and does a bunch of MAT on me, and he's going to fix me right up.
On the right, Dan.
You've spoken a lot about how much you enjoy YouTube golf and that side of it. What do you enjoy about tournament golf?
What I did on 14, by making a putt and just knowing that I accomplished something under the gun, under pressure situation, that's my favorite thing about tournament golf. When that pressure's on and I execute like I know how I can, there's no better feeling in the world.
Back left, Patrick.
Bryson, hi. How much have you embraced the role of being the showman out there? So much energy, wonderful support from the fans. What has that come to mean to you?
I mean, it's meant a lot to me. Just thinking back 3 years ago, you know, the landscape was a lot different, and I tried to show everybody who I was. I didn't do it the right way, and could have done a lot of things better. And I'm lucky enough to have a great team around me to help me move in the right direction with the content that we're producing, social media, and then also just a great perspective on life. Those combination of things have allowed me to have not only a new perspective, but an opportunity to show myself in a different light and to entertain the fans out there on the golf course.
And that regret you referenced, how much do you look back on that now with regret?
It's not a regret. It's a learning experience. I never regret anything in life. Do I not like what I did? Absolutely. But every moment that I live in this life, I'm always trying to learn from my mistakes. And so could you have called it a mistake? Sure. I mean, you can call it a bunch of things, but for the most part, the most important piece of it all is that you're growing and learning, and you're growing from those moments. That's the best thing I can say to anyone out there that's struggling, essentially, to say, hey, if you're in a bad spot, get some good people around you, give yourself a new perspective on life, and get after it. and show them who you truly are, you know, no matter what situation you're in. And that's one of the pieces of advice that I give to anybody that's struggling.
A few more back right.
Bryson, you started talking about hitting it towards the middle of the green, but I wonder, the second shots on 13 and 14, did you intend to be that aggressive?
Don't expose it, okay? You know? No, certainly on 13, I was going for the flag, knowing the wind was off the right, and if it went over to the left, totally fine, but I hit it, I pushed it just a little bit, and it drew it back perfectly at the flag on 13, so I knew that was in the realm of possibilities, got a little lucky there, and then 14, I was trying to hit it more toward Ludwig's ball, and I hit a great shot, just didn't start out with any draw spin, and the wind kind of pushed it right towards the flag, and that's kind of what you're doing out here, is you're trying to play conservative golf that gives you the opportunity to hit it close in some scenarios. That's the best way I can describe it.
Stay back right, Kevin.
Bryson, I've heard you talk a lot about how good it is to have equipment that suits your personality, that you feel comfortable with. You've had a lot of success doing things your way. I wondered, have any players ever come to you and said, Bryson, I want to learn more about this. Like, I'd like to try single length irons. I'd like to try a crank driver. I'd like to do things this way because you've shown me a different way, or has it just been you doing it solo?
I'm always here to give information. I'm an open book. I've always said that, even to any of the players. And for the most part, people are doing their own things. They have their own contracts with their own equipment companies, and that's more power to them and whatever they're comfortable with. I'm certainly comfortable with what I'm using right now. I've got great product in hands, even the single-length irons. I've been using LA golf shafts, graphite golf shafts, since 2018. Most people forget that fact. I've been playing graphite iron shafts for a long time now, and in the putter as well. So I've always kind of done things a little different, and I'm glad I've got a solid team around me that helps give me the right equipment so that under the gun, I'm as comfortable as I possibly can be. And on the driver's side, it's a recently discovered thing last year, and I've said it online numerous times. I've talked to people about it, and we'll see if it makes an impact. I'm not here to decide the future of equipment and the game of golf, but I certainly do know what works for me and what will work for a lot of high ball speed players.
Last question here, front left.
Hey, Bryson, Dan here.
Dan.
So we love following your journey with discovery and trying things. And yeah. I think in a lot of ways, the golf nerd and all of us sort of perks up a little bit to go, man, I never thought of that. And one of the things the announcers were talking a lot about today was the floating the balls in Epsom salt. And, you know, a lot of the fans were out there listening in on the little radio pieces. Yeah. And they became a fan of this thing they were calling the salty balls. but my question to you is can you? How did you come to that? How did you discover it? What led you to that? And what is that doing for,
man,
you know, your game?
Thanks for the salty balls question. I appreciate that. yeah, I put my golf balls in Epsom salt. I'm lucky enough that Connor, my manager, does that now. I don't have to do it. But essentially, we float golf balls in a solution to make sure that the golf ball is not out of balance. There's a big thing back in the day where golf balls were out of balance. And it's just because of the manufacturing process. There's always going to be an error, especially when it's a sphere. You can't, and there's dimples on the edges. You can't perfectly get it in the center. So what I'm doing is finding the pretty much out of balanceness of it, how much out of balance it is. Heavy side floats to the bottom. Heavy side floats to the bottom. And then we mark the top with a dot to make sure that it's always rolling over itself. It kind of acts like mud. So if there's too much weight on one side, you can put it 90 degrees to where the mud's on the right-hand side or the mud's on the left-hand side. I'm using mud as a reference for the weight that's over there. And it'll fly differently and fly inconsistently. Now, for most golf balls that we get, it's not really that big of a deal. I just try to be as precise as possible, and it's one more step that I do to make sure my golf ball flies as straight as it possibly can fly, because I'm not that great at hitting it that straight. So,
that's awesome. Thank you.
Yeah.
Great round today, Bryson. Good luck tomorrow.
Thanks, guys.